right. Good morning, good evening, wherever you are in the world. My name's Will Travis. I'm of Elevation Barn, and I'm a board member at Mission Blue. And tonight, I'm absolutely delighted to be presenting on the Blue Hope podcast, Going Deep with Seaspiracy. Seaspiracy has shocked millions of viewers by shining a blinding light on the ugly truths inherent in the global industrial fishing industry. The film also shows how humanity's fish-eating habits are fueling widespread and catastrophic destruction of the ocean. As it climbed to Netflix's coveted top 10 list, the documentary has stirred controversy and invigorated environmentally minded people to take action, many on this call tonight. For many, this documentary has changed the way we see the ocean. Our habits, our participation in the global industrial fishing industry has previously and has not yet thoroughly been scrutinized at such a widespread public level. As a bit of housekeeping before we go in, there will be a Q&A at the end of this webinar where the panel will take questions that are submitted by the public on the Zoom. So please do jot your notes down there. On our panel this evening, I'm absolutely honored to be welcoming Dr. Sylvia Earle. She's the president and chairman of Mission Blue, a National Geographic Society explorer in residence. Her deepness, as many of us who love her know her, and she's the living legend by the Library of Congress and the first hero of the planet by Time magazine. She's an oceanographer, explorer, author, lecturer, with a lifetime of experience as a field research scientist, government official, and director of corporate and nonprofit organizations. Her deepness, thank you for hosting with me this evening. Joining her are the fabulous Ali and Lucy Tabrizi. They're going to be joining us live from Folkestone in Kent, my home country. Thank you for joining us there. Ali grew up on the southwest coast of England, spending much of his earlier childhood exploring the world with his camera, daydreaming about the ocean and the hidden world beneath the waves. His family moved from Iran several years during the time of political turmoil and revolution, and he became intimately aware of the untold stories and how they can lead to corruption and injustice, sparking his interest in a war of photojournalism. His interest in wanting to expose the truth and his passion for environmental issues soon led him to the filmmaking and starting Disrupt Studios and working with Netflix original documentary series, resulting in the reason that we're all gathered here tonight to discuss Seaspiracy. Lucy, his wing lady, was born in Melbourne, Australia, and growing up, she was never far from the sea. Originally studying to welcome an architect, she became disenchanted with the career choice and wanted to get more involved in something she cared more deeply about. For many years of traveling, she's become immensely concerned about conservation and the unethical treatment of our species. Combining her passion with the natural world and her creative skill set, she's dedicated to further the conservation and effective environmental and animal advocacies. So thank you, Ali and Lucy. I know you are absolutely rammed busy with so much journalism inquiries at the moment. So thank you for making time to join us this evening. Also joining us is Max Bello. He's an international ocean policy expert who has worked in the environmental arena for over two decades, advancing marine conservation priorities. He's worked for non-governmental organizations in Chile and the United States, including the Pew Charities Trusts, Oceana, the World Wildlife Fund, Island Conservation, and the Blue Whale Center, among others. Mr. Bello has operated with a wide array of international fora, including the United Nations and its various conventions and bodies. Thanks for joining us, Max. So, to start the motors going, a question for you, Ali and Lucy, if you don't mind, and rather than sort of candy coating everything, let's just sort of cut to the chase. Seaspiracy has clearly captured the attention of many around the world. Millions of people are engaged and on board with this. It's such an exciting topic. Yet some feel that certain groups of people and organizations were treated unfairly. Some are questioning the science presented. So before we jump into the discussion, we had a fabulous talk about that. And as journalists and reporters and documentarians, you had a clear point of view. Would you like to respond just to those perspectives that are bubbling to the surface?
Yeah, so the film obviously has received a lot of attention around the world, and it's something that shocked us because we kind of never built the film in such a way to withstand world pressure, and yet it's held up, which is great to see. And when it's come to some of the science of the film, there's been a couple of numbers that have come up more than others. And one of them was, for example, a quote in the film about 2048 being a year that if fishing trends continue, we could see virtually empty oceans by 2048. And there's been some claims that the study is old and outdated and has been retracted, when in fact, we outline it quite clearly on our website fact page that actually it hasn't been retracted. It's been cited over 3,000 times. And I believe one of the original authors came back more recently and found that some of the fish populations they studied are in a worse state now than they were back then. And basically, a more recent study also stated, I think it was the United Nations Special Envoy for the Oceans, 2018, I think, basically stated that by 2050, 90% of typical fish stocks might be collapsed by then. So this date, whether it's 2048, 2050, it doesn't really matter. It could be 2068. The point is that we're splitting hairs here, and the trajectory of our oceans isn't going in a good direction. And another fact actually that came up was the number of sea turtles that are killed as bycatch. That was another one that was brought to our attention. And it appeared that we had repeated an original mistake by an NGO, Sea Turtle Conservancy, that misattributed it just to the United States, when the number of, when they actually was meaning it to be applied to the whole planet. We did some more research and it actually found that the number's far worse than 250,000 that we quote in the film. It's actually more in the region of 500,000 sea turtles quoted in the film. And there's been some other small discrepancies, things like that, but it hasn't changed the message of the film one bit, I don't think. But,
yeah, and I also think that a lot of the criticism when it comes to the science and statistic, they're saying we have to be really critical about the film, and that's true, but it needs to run on both sides as well. So a lot of the criticism, I think there needs to be some fact checking on that side as well. Like a lot of the things have misquoted the film. For example, there was one that we said, 46%, 50% of the plastic in the ocean is fishing net, and that's not what we said. We said it is the Great Pacific Garbage Patch. Another one, we made the claim that whales were washing up and they'd been killed because of plastic. We never made that claim again. So I think we just need to be careful. Often what can happen is like there's a criticism and then people just take it and run with it without actually watching the film or, scrutinizing these criticisms themselves. Mm. That being said, when it comes to the groups, you mentioned the group, I just want to say for the record that I don't believe we misrepresented any groups or treated any groups unfairly. We believe we portrayed them accurately. And, we just asked some straightforward questions, and that might be difficult for some of these groups which haven't been asked these questions in that kind of manner before, or they haven't, had to answer them. So in that sense, perhaps it was difficult, but we don't believe we were misrepresenting anyone. And that can be further seen by these groups in their statements since the film has come out. They have actually, the Dolphin Project, Plastic Pollution Collision, Oceana have released statements doubling down on their position in the
Dolphin
film.
Save Tuna.
Sorry.
Not Dolphin Project.
Sorry, not Dolphin Project. Dolphin Save Tuna have come out and just reiterated their position, which we portrayed in the film as well. Yeah. Do you want to talk about the...
if you'll unmute, how would you like to respond to that as well? Sylvia, can you hear us? You're on mute over there.
So, I really applaud Ollie and Lucy for their approach of simply asking questions and reporting the answers that they received, and taking a different perspective than many who look at the ocean as a source of products, a kind of innocence, like as a child might, why are we doing this? looking at the ocean with 21st century eyes. I've lived most of my life so far in the 20th century, when policies were directed and laws were made that we still live by. That is, really looking at the ocean as a place where we can take things whether it's fishing or mining or whatever, we take things out of the ocean and value the ocean based on what we can extract, or as a place where we can dump things. The value of the ocean as a place where we can throw things, quotes, away. Or we look at the ocean as a place mainly as for transportation. The Navy looks at the ocean primarily as a medium through which, over which ships can travel or through which submarines can go, but not as the ocean as the ocean. In the 21st century, we are both we're living through the time of the greatest loss of what we have done to the ocean, what we've taken out, what we've put in, and we've changed the nature of the ocean. But at the same time, we've learned more. And Ollie and Lucy have come along at a time when we can see the world differently. You've grown up, Ollie and Lucy, knowing what Earth looks like from afar, knowing that the world is basically blue, knowing that the ocean really affects climate and weather. Those things were not known largely during the 20th century, or that there were limits to what we could take out or what we could put into the ocean. So I really applaud your approach of doing what I suggest everyone should do, and what children do naturally. You ask questions: who, what, why, where, when, how, and then look at the evidence. You've been looking at the evidence with fresh eyes. Many of the critics of Seaspiracy are burdened with habits that have developed during a previous time when our values were really directed at pounds of meat, barrels of oil. But you've also seen the change, and I've been a witness to change. We used to look at whales as products. When I was a child, whalers were still thought of as heroes. They were conquering the ocean. They were battling the elements. They were coming back with products that were of value to human civilization. Well, we changed. We changed the attitude about turtles, sea turtles. Again, when I was a kid, turtle steak was featured in Florida as a delectable item on the menus. And turtles were held in holding places in the Florida Keys waiting for sale. Well, I witnessed the change of attitude. We haven't changed our attitude much about fish. Tuna are still traded as products, as money. We look at ocean wildlife the way we used to look at whales as seals as products. We're looking at krill as products, not as animals to be viewed with a more complete value. What are they worth? What's a whale worth? What's a tuna worth? And more than just putting a dollar sign on wildlife, I think what you exposed was that element of what humans pride themselves in having, which is being able to feel the pain of others, empathy, sympathy. I think in the 21st century, we've begun to see that elephants have empathy and sympathy for one another, that whales have empathy and sympathy. I think it's become clear that fish, some species that we've been intimate with and have observed, can show what we might, if it weren't a fish, we would say they show affection. But why can't we just free ourselves of preconceived ideas and do just what you've been doing? Ask questions. Why? How? And to just, you know, it helps to learn from what we've learned, you know, take in what we've discovered from the past, but to also question those habits, those attitudes. And when it comes to the ethics of fishing, to look at life in the sea with fresh eyes and to say, isn't this wrong? Isn't what we're doing somehow wrong? To take on an industrial scale, living creatures without any compassion for them and their suffering. I mean, some of my learned colleagues will say, you've got to get over that. You're a fish hugger. Well, okay, I do feel an empathy for the creatures and what they must be feeling. I have, and I think all of us should try to view others, the viewpoint of others, and take that into account as part of what are we doing to the world? What is our place in the world? Can we treat others with respect, whether it's an elephant, a whale, or a tuna, or a krill? It doesn't mean that we won't continue to extract ocean wildlife to support both our desires, our habits, and also, in some cases, our needs. But we should at least be prepared to accept the reality of what is it that we're actually doing and where are we going with this? Can we actually imagine feeding large numbers of people with wildlife? Could we do it with songbirds? Could we do it with little furry things from the land? Large numbers of people? And can we do it from the ocean on a large scale? I think you're absolutely right, Ollie and Lucy, to be asking these questions and to be transparent about what you find. We should not be, well, we should all be doing exactly what you're doing.
Ali, when you started the film, you talk about it being maybe a bit of a different film when it started out. And as things evolved, things started to change in your mind. Excuse me. How was it keeping the tenacity going? Because what I feel has been a great success of the film is you have shone this light on the biggest issue, which is we are mistreating our ocean, regardless of the elements underneath. That's the elephant in the room or the whale in our bath. How was it keeping the tenacity going with obstacle after obstacle from government officials, police forces, etc.? Was there a point where the two of you were like, you know what, we've bitten off too much here?
Yeah, there were many moments during the making of the film that we both had feelings of like, are we even gonna finish this film? You know, after we penciled in that it'd maybe take us a year to do, 2 years to do, 3 years to do, by that point it's like this film's never going to end because there's just no way to tell the story of our oceans in an hour and a half that pieces together all these different stories. There have been films in the past that we'd seen, you know, whether that be, you know, Sharkwater or The Cove, and they've been about those single issues and we weren't sure we were going to be able to do it. And so there are definitely moments like that, and I think what was really keeping us going is like the curiosity we had that was driving us, and then we felt like we'd achieve like a milestone of like exposing something and finding something out. That would be a huge drive for us because we were like, well, we wanted to know this. We feel betrayed by knowing this information. Why weren't we told this information? And we wanted to get it out there. So that was really, I think, if I speak for both of us, that was really like driving us both to persist in the making of the film.
Yeah, Sylvia. I mean, Sylvia, you've had this tenacity.
Feeling completely overwhelmed. Sorry, can you hear me?
Sorry, go on, Lucy. I missed you.
Yeah, just a feeling of being overwhelmed throughout the whole film because, as Ali said, we were trying to tackle not single issues but many issues, and it was very difficult to string these all together into a package, into a story that's going to communicate and relate to an audience. So there was many tricky times when we just didn't know how to finish it, and it's one of those things that you could work on forever. I mean, things that you're constantly learning. You know, we're still learning. And it just, it's one of those things that you just, at some point, you just have to stop and share what you've got. And that's, I think that's what kept me going is we have to get this out. We have to share this. We have to share what we've found out.
And how's the impact now for the two of you? I mean, it's one job capturing and creating a film like this, it's a second job living with it and trying to navigate, you know, the bombardment that you must get left, right, and center as somebody that's trying to help the world.
Yeah, our lives have been really thrown upside down, and we were not expecting the overwhelming response. I mean, I think for the first like month, we were getting like 10 direct messages a minute just on Instagram. And our emails, it was like another like 10 emails a minute as well. And it was just overwhelming. And having the world's media, I mean, I never thought we'd be written about in Vogue magazine. I mean, every, you name it, we've been written about there. And I think it's also bizarre because the film has come out during a time of COVID where there's not been physical screenings and premieres. And so it's been hard to really gauge the response on a personal level with people, and just having to base it on, you know, how many people have hashtagged it and now it's trending and now it's number one on Netflix. But what does that really mean? Like, what's the true impact of it? So it's been really hard to gauge that. And yeah, I mean, the two times we've been recognized from the film, it's literally been out of our doorstep, people walking past our door. So it's we have no idea really what, like, to gauge the impact. It's bizarre.
Yeah, I don't think there's a dinner I've been to where somebody says, yeah, I'm not eating fish. And it's not just because I'm living in Bali where, you know, we're a little bit more connected to nature, but you've had a massive impact. But just on a bigger picture, you know, Seaspiracy does paint a very dark picture of the state of the oceans. Is it really that bad?
Short answer, yes, I think it is that bad.
Yeah, the film speaks for itself in many ways.
And there were so many things we couldn't fit into to the 90 minutes as well. We're at a crucial point where I think we're at a turning point. We have to do something. We have to make big change now because we're just, that trajectory is heading down. And yeah, I do think it's that bad. Mm.
And I think it's echoed as well through the fact that even on a governmental level, from a leadership standpoint, I don't think governments have a clue, quite frankly, on how to protect the ocean. Do you want to talk about that?
Yeah, I mean, around the UK and the marine protected areas, 97% of these marine protected areas still allow bottom trawling. Mm. So it just goes to show that our leaders don't really know what to do about this. They don't really know how to tackle this issue.
And then I think that rings down. Yeah, in the UK, 71 out of 73 MPAs continue to allow bottom trawling. And I think there's loopholes that they're able to say, hey, we've created marine protected areas, aren't we great? You look into the fine print and you find out that they're actually not protecting the seas from anything. It might be, you know, from this month to this month, there's no jet skiing or there's no surfing allowed. It's okay, well, that's not a marine protected area. You need to create a no-take zone. We need to create a sanctuary. We wouldn't stand for this if we create an Amazon protected area and you continue to allow logging. But that's how we're treating our oceans. So the oceans really are that bad, and it's reflected by the fact governments are not taking any proper leadership on it.
Yeah, it leads out into so many different areas. Max, I was going to ask you, what's the latest on fishing subsidiary negotiations at the WTO? And will this affect overfishing? Is there anything happening there?
I mean, it's been a very long discussion, you know, for many years, actually. And we're finally kind of trying to get something out that actually have to do mostly with the industry, actually, because that's where most of the subsidies actually are going. And they're enabling some of these huge fleets to fish around everywhere, right in front of all the countries. We've seen it, you know, just lately in front of Galapagos, Chile and Argentina with the Chinese fleet. And there are many others too, you know, they're Japanese, they're Korean, they're the European Union, who have a long story, not just of fishing on the high seas, but also buying or contracting, you know, with those countries, doing agreements to actually fish inside of their EEC. And in Latin America, you can see it all the time. I mean, to those questions, to that discussion that was just, we're having, you know, we see it, for example, with the salmon farming in south of Chile. It's one of, like, it's my home. It is one of the most beautiful places on earth. And people, you know, like many groups, like Defendamos Chiloé and many other groups that are rooted in these areas need voices to actually tell the story about how these places have been destroyed by big companies, big industrial fishing that is feeding those salmon farmings or those salmons that actually they don't even belong to those places. And I think what I am worried about is sometimes is, you know, there's a lot of criticism on like, why is it this, you know, this movie saying this or that, but what about the criticism? Why we don't focus that criticism into what is actually going on out there with those companies, with that industry, with that destruction that we see it. We've seen it for, 20, 30, 40 years in Latin America. Chile and Peru have a long history of actually using one resource after the other, because as Sylvia was saying, we see the ocean as that one resource. It's finished, let's go for the other. Let's go for the next. And that it's not the way that we can treat the ocean, which is the source of life on Earth. So we are putting ourselves in big danger.
Yeah, there's a question in from Sam here. Says, we can change our family's fish eating habits, but it seems like big fish companies and seafood restaurants need to step up, acknowledge the issues and make these changes. It seems to boil down to greed and money, doesn't it? Any thoughts on that one?
Well, we've had some great response from people just through our direct messages on social media, people who are seafood chefs or own restaurants, or there was a store in Hong Kong that is now taking seafood, or I should just call marine wildlife, off of their shelves and stop selling it and reconsidering their menus and shifting towards a more plant-based menu. So the film has been applicable not only to individuals, but also to companies and institutions and organizations as well. So there is good change happening.
What are we hearing from the upcoming COP15 Biodiversity Summit and the development of the post-2020 biodiversity framework that is supposed to include this 30% of land and ocean being protected? What's happening there, Max or Sylvia?
Well, I think I will repeat that Sylvia normally talks about this is a good first step. I think the 30% is just a good first step. And I like one other thing that Sylvia and other people have been mentioning. If you go to the doctor, you don't try to save just part the 30% of your body to go to the doctor. Like you don't go to the doctor and say like, hey, can you save my arm, you know, for this? The ocean works as a whole, and we've seen it. I mean, I've seen it in the, you know, in the region also in the East Tropical Pacific, where most shark have been taken. If you go and look, for example, in the market in China, a huge percentage, some species, over 80%, over 70% of some of the species are actually brought from that region. So that region, it's actually been, you know, completely erased from sharks. And we've seen those declines. And it's extremely worrisome because it doesn't just affect the sharks, it will affect the whole ecosystem. And so going 30%, it's the minimum we can really do. But we have seen, for example, like my own country, Chile, have done already 43% of highly and fully protection. And it makes me proud. We need still a lot of more implementing and enforcing that is for sure. It is a big task. But we have other countries that are stepping on as well, doing the same. I think we need to realize that that's exactly the road that we need to take. We've tried the other road. We've tried putting money onto big business, onto big fisheries, and it's just driving us to this catastrophic sort of situation. So what else we can do? Well, let's change then the views, you know, and let's actually put our brain to work on something that is different, and that is protection. And it's not even new, Will. I mean, Polynesian groups have been, Polynesian people have been doing marine protected areas, Rahui and Tapus, you know, for thousands of years. I mean, we know already for a long time that actually marine protected areas works. And so why wouldn't put more effort on that?
I mean, just building off there, is there such thing as sustainable fishery? Sylvia, I think you're going to dive in on this one.
Well, I shall, but let me observe that there are three main avenues of what I would consider hope at this point. One is focus on climate, the big headline of our time in terms of the environment. People are beginning to truly acknowledge that humans are changing the nature of nature through what we're putting into the atmosphere, and also how excess carbon dioxide is turning the ocean to be more acidic, and other ways that we're changing the chemistry of the ocean, the chemistry of the planet, and the temperature of the ocean, the temperature of the planet. The other avenue you mentioned is the biodiversity focus, that awareness that it's the complexity of life on Earth, the diverse systems that create the stability that we've always taken for granted, but we're putting at risk right now. But most of the attention, quite frankly, has been placed on terrestrial biodiversity, protection of rainforests because of their enormous diversity, and looking at coral reefs because of their great diversity, but missing the point that the ocean really not only has most of life on Earth, but it's where the greatest diversity of life, concerning the big wedges of diversity, the 30 plus main groups of animals that make up the network of life on Earth. Only about half have representation on the land, but they're basically all out there in the ocean, in a place that you can embrace with your arms out in the open ocean. It's a big nursery area. The whole ocean is filled with the young of many kinds of organisms, and of course the grown-ups as well. But the diversity of life that you can see in a place you can embrace with your arms in mud, or in a coral reef, or out in the open sea, the diversity of life is fantastic. And yet we are still terrestrial, and we look at the land as being the level of where the highest protection should be given if we're going to safeguard the planet for ourselves. Really, we need to think of the diversity of wild animals in the ocean as that which safeguards stability. We look at wildlife in the ocean as products. We think of wildlife trade, and we should. Elephants, rhinoceroses, birds, our fellow primates that are being traded, in some cases legally, mostly illegally. But the biggest wildlife trade on the planet is fish, krill, you know, what we call seafood. It's wildlife. If we could just wrap our minds around that simple observation, which Ollie and Lucy really put the spotlight on, these are wild animals that we're taking, and we're treating them as if they're just, you know, rocks. And even what we're taking out of the ocean is for mining is having consequences that is another whole topic. But the third avenue really comes to half of the world. We're looking at a major policies right now directed toward the high seas, and an effort along with 30% of the land, 30% of coastal waters that are under national jurisdiction, to look at the high seas. It's the global commons. It's the area that, when you think about it, most of the life out there lives in the dark all of the time. And it's not a small amount of life. We're talking about half the world, almost half the world, with this layer of life called the deep scattering zone, this place that's been a source of food for creatures of the sea that travel the high seas, the whales, the turtles, the birds that fly over long distances. What are they eating when they go out to sea beyond areas of national jurisdiction? Squid and small fish, and many creatures that live mostly in the dark, but they come up close to the surface at night to feed on the remains of what has been produced by phytoplankton and zooplankton during the day. And then they sink back down deep into the sea to 100 meters or even as much as 1,000 meters in the dark, where they live most of their life. And for ages. This has been part of what maintains ocean chemistry, the carbon cycle. We're beginning now in the 21st century to recognize this as a basic fundamental process that shapes the habitability of Earth for all of life, not just life in the sea, but all of life. I want to say it's the carbon cycle, stupid. I won't say that. Oh, I did just say that, didn't I? But we need to follow the carbon. We're on the land, we see trees as valuable, precious carbon capturing organisms. And in the soil, where does the carbon go? It's anchored in the soil after it's captured. And we're beginning to respect that. But the ocean, we're just beginning to open our eyes. And thank you, Ali and Lucy, for opening our eyes to some of these questions and putting it out there. You are observing carefully and to the best of your ability, reporting honestly what you discover. That's what everyone should be doing. Instead of nitpicking things that you found that others might object to, look at the big picture that you exposed to in a way that no one has been able to do before. Another film that has made waves recently and shot from obscurity up to headlines is My Octopus Teacher. My Octopus Teacher, Craig Foster, observing carefully, reporting honestly what he saw, and changing the way people think about life in the sea. An octopus, for heaven's sakes. You see octopus on the menu all over the world. But he, through his different way of looking, has caused people to see not just octopuses, but to have that compassion, that sense of looking at the world through the eyes of other creatures. And then you came along and similarly have aroused a new way of looking at life in the sea. Bravo. Bravo. And it's that ethic that we need to grasp. And just think about, how did we come to think the way we do about fish? What is it that causes us to have a different attitude about pandas and tunas? Why are we so slow to recognize the value beyond pounds of meat and barrels of oil or products of various sorts that come from living organisms? It just, I think, is time that we confront the reality, this new way of looking at the value of the living world. And we're seeing it with policies about the high seas, policies about marine protected areas generally, policies about climate, policies about the diversity of life. And to question, just as you have questioned, why are we, what's out of alignment here? Can't we just take a fresh look at how our place within the natural systems that make our existence possible? And might we not recognize that the most important thing that we take from the ocean, that we take from nature, is our existence? We live because all of the rest of life on Earth, it has prepared the planet in a way, not consciously, but 4.5 billion years of fine tuning. And here we have a planet that works in our favor. And in about 4.5 decades, mostly in ignorance, we have unraveled those systems and taken from the land and now taking from the sea on a scale that the planet simply cannot accept without serious change. But this is the first time that we can understand it and see it and act on it. And that's where you, Ali and Lucy, have brought us, I think, just saying, how can we continue to take on this scale and still have a planet that works in our favor? And how can we as humans continue to treat animals with such indifference when we know better?
Sylvia, bring up a critical point there. Ali and Lucy, just from that point of view, there's probably many filmmakers and documentarians and researchers that have reached out in support of your style of storytelling, and the success of any action is based on the power of the story. What kind of advice and guidance can you pass on to those people that are looking to tell stories to help propel change?
I think any good story is one of transformation. And I think it's going from a place of darkness and ignorance and maybe lies to a place of hopefully awareness and truth. And that's true in virtually every movie that you've ever seen. There's usually some transformation. And I think the greater the ignorance or the greater the lie, and in many cases it's the lie that we believe internally, showing that internal and external conflict in that journey is something that I think is a powerful storytelling element. In fact, you can't separate it from storytelling. And with a film like this, there was a huge amount of conflict to be shown, whether that be coming from government, industries, the betrayal of maybe environmental groups that you would have hoped would be addressing the whale in the bathtub, as you said. And there's a lot of that, and also the internal conflict of someone who's loved the ocean and thought I was doing what I could, only to find that I was actually, you know, saying I love dolphins on one hand, and then the other hand sticking that piece of tuna or whatever it is in my mouth that likely would have killed dolphins along the way it got to my shelf on the supermarket shelf. So I think in terms of a tip, I think it's just always exploring that mode of transformation and always trying to move towards truth, whatever truth means, just trying to go in that direction and away from ignorance, I think.
I'll just add to that everything Ali said. I think passion is so much more important than, the technicalities of it, like run on passion. You can, and also use your skills to do what you can to add to it and do your part.
Yeah, passion, big one, passion. None of us went to film school. None of us had made a film before this. So our first ever film is a Netflix original because it was just driven on passion and our drive to tell this important story.
Will, I want to add to this discussion too. I think you started with a question also about the sustainability. I think we have to recognize that sustainability is being used in many ways. You know, I remember even when, you know, organic even, I remember when I went my first time when I went to study in Scotland, I did my master there and we were taken to an organic farm and it wasn't really organic. What I was expecting was like no chemicals, but it was like a lower level of chemical, the same chemicals, you know, and we get, you know, sometimes confused about what those things mean. And it makes it easier. It makes it easier for you to go and buy without being guilty in a way, no? And so if someone put the leveling of sustainability, it is easier for us, but it's not that easy. It is definitely not that easy. And the differences and the use of the word, it's been, I think, a little bit too far. And I know communities that have been, fighting for their resources that have a lower impact. And I will potentially, you know, I think they are sustainable in many ways. And for example, the Juan Fernandez community, an archipelago in Chile, which they are incredible people who have been, you know, fighting for saving their resources to stop first, you know, the bottom trawling, and then they for industrial, they went to create, actually with the support of Oceana Chile, a marine protected area of more than 200,000 kilometers square. I mean, as a community, which they care about their resources and the ocean, they've been doing a great job. And I think there are many of those examples. But I think using just the leveling of sustainability for comparison this to the, for example, like big fleet of tuna fishing that extract more than 600,000 tons of tuna a year. I mean, it is not the same, no? And so we can't use it that way. And so for people that are asking a lot about what is a sustainable, what, you know, what is actually, you know, are there examples of sustainability? I would say I've seen things that we could eventually maybe call it if we get to an agreement of some sort of like definition of that, but definitely that they have a lower impact and that they feed the community, and the community does a lot more than just extracting, but actually they trying to take care of a much bigger piece of their impact. And so for those, for me, those things are important to mention. Knowing that most of the fishing industry have an incredible range. We said about you know, the subsidies. We talk about high seas, which basically have no frame now to create marine protected areas out there. They can go fishing everywhere. So what are the parameters that we have, you know? I mean, we need to create real parameters. We can't just like FAO call it, you know, like the maximal sustainable yield, because calling it now sustainability. How is that sustainable? How that could be sustainable? Who decide to, and under what kind of, you know, definition is that sustainable, and how that compares to that community in this, in Chile? You know, those things, I think people need to be aware, and they need to find also what they want, what is also their impact. And also I would add to that, not just on what you consume, but also how you are electing, how are you electing politicians that are supporting that or don't? I think those things are extremely key for me.
I wanted to jump in there as well, because a lot of those, yeah, those maximum sustainable yield or whatever it might be, they don't take into consideration the impact that removing that species will have on the rest of the wildlife. Human beings are not a natural predator of the ocean. We're not meant to be 1,000 miles out at sea, you know, targeting thousands of tons of marine life. What those ecosystems, I mean, often work in balance with the rest of the predators. So if we take the fish, what are the dolphins going to eat? But this is an impact that isn't taken into account often with those certifications. And ultimately in the film, we ask the question, okay, what does sustainability actually mean? And we come to this realization, this epiphany towards the end of the movie. It just means that something can continue on and on forever, regardless of the suffering that it might incur. And we have to ask ourselves the question, what kind of species do we want to be? Who do we want to define ourselves as? Do we want to do something that lasts forever, this sort of eternal, like Dante's Inferno of death? Do we really want to do that if it's sustainable? Shouldn't we just ask ourselves, do we want to do what's right? You know, that's the most important thing for me.
Yeah, and a lot of the language around maximum sustainable yield is, like, it doesn't take into account at all historic levels, what they used to be several decades ago. So it might drop down to say like 3%, and then it's up to say 5%. We say, oh, well, it's recovering, it's recovered, it's sustainable. I don't think any, correct me if I'm wrong, any fish stocks out there have ever come anywhere near back to their historic levels, and they were several decades ago. So I think the overall picture is what we need to be looking at, and not these terms that really obscure what it really means to consumers. And that's the ultimate thing. Consumers need to be able to understand, they need to be able to purchase based on this, and it needs to be understandable, and it's not.
Okay, if I weigh in, Will?
Please.
Do we want a sustainable planet for us within the natural systems that keep us alive? We have to change our attitude about the value of nature, land and ocean, and realize that there are limits to what we can take from nature and still have a viable planet in terms of the systems that we heretofore have always not only taken for granted, but could take for granted. When our numbers were small, 1800, there were only a billion of us. When I came along, that number had doubled. Now we're close to 8 billion. And we still have the habits and the attitude about nature that we had when our numbers were much smaller. and when nature was much more intact. The idea of maximum sustainable yield was born early in the 20th century. And along the way, even when there were fewer of us and when the ocean was far more intact, scientists came to realize that this is a system that is fraught with false expectations. It's not a system that really, I mean, the idea just doesn't work for the very reasons that Ali and Lucy and Max articulated. This is a complex world. And the idea of maximum sustainable yield, when it first was applied to cod and to whales, really focused on individual species, not realizing how closely connected they are to the other creatures. Okay, we began to see how flawed that system is, but meanwhile, it got into laws, expectations, policies that we can, we thought, manage fish, manage whales, manage turtles, manage whatever it is. No, we need to manage ourselves, obviously. The whales will do what the whales will do. The cod will do what the cod will do. And there are complexities that we don't even know what questions to ask in some cases. Like, what if you take away a lot of the cod, what does that do to the lobsters? Well, it turns out that it's probably good for the lobsters because there are fewer cod eating the baby lobsters in New England, for example. And then what do you do? So you've got a system that's out of kilter because of our impact. You've taken away a large component or reduced its numbers. And there are other impacts along the way. Take away the sharks, 90% of the, most of the big sharks, more in some cases like the oceanic white tip, I mean, maybe 1% remain in the ocean from what was there in the 1970s. And other species too, we're really good at killing. We're really good. We found immensely powerful ways to find and capture and market ocean wildlife, just as we have done on the land to find, capture, and market wildlife, with consequences to the planet as a whole, to the carbon cycle, to the nitrogen cycle, to the generation of oxygen, to the systems, the chemistry of the planet. This is the first time in the history of our species that we have been able to look at the planet as a whole. There are plenty of gaps, of things we don't know, we don't know. But we know enough to know that we are altering the basic chemistry of the planet through what we're putting into the atmosphere, what we're putting into the ocean, and also what we're taking out. The way that we are altering the composition of the diversity of life. And not just the individual species. It's not just having two or three of something that we still have 1% of the oceanic white-tip sharks. What is their role when they're healthy? These are big carbon-based units, but they also give nutrients back to the ocean in ways that we're just beginning to ask the questions, let alone to come up with the answer about how do we have a sustainable planet? What's the maximum number of people that the planet can accommodate behaving as we currently do? It turns out that if we continue behaving as we currently are behaving, our impact on the planet is disastrous. The sustainability of us within the natural systems that keep us alive, continuing doing what we're doing, it just can't work. We're beginning to face up to that at the same time that we're continuing, based on old habits and even laws that make it legal to extract on a scale that is not sustainable no matter how you slice it. It's just not working. But we're still maintaining this belief that we can do it. We can have maximum sustainable yield because it's in the law. It doesn't matter what the laws of nature say. We should somehow believe that we can pull it off. So what Ollie and Lucy have achieved, I think, is putting a light that hasn't been successful in doing to the world as a whole before. I mean, there are lots of scientific papers that show we're in a trend of decline. Lots of scientific papers that show the chemistry of the ocean is changing, chemistry of the atmosphere is changing, red lights are flashing. But what you have done is taken it to the public in a way that says, we've got some problems. What are we going to do about it? At the same time that the world is saying, we have to have new policies of protection. 30% by 2030 is a good place to start. But we have to think it through. How do we manage ourselves so that we can maintain a place for ourselves within the natural systems that create a viable planet? We have the power to do this if we face up to the reality of what we're actually doing to the systems that keep us alive. And hope, I think what you have drawn us to is, now that we know the magnitude of the problems, maybe we can get serious about taking some actions. Personally, individual choices, laws that maybe were put in place when the world was a different place, but it has changed. We have to change the laws to keep up with the reality that the expectation of being able to continue to extract wildlife by the ton from the ocean, not even respecting them as individuals, by the ton, the way we used to take the whales by the ton, and now we respect them as individuals. I mean, this is a time as never before when we should be thrilled to be alive, because we know what we know that we could not know when I was a kid, that you've been the beneficiaries of what has come along, and you've taken it to heart. And you're saying, you're asking the world, what are we doing? What are we thinking? Can we think differently? Can we individually and together come up with a better plan for how we treat nature? What's wrong with that? Seems to me we're at the best place we've ever been to really have a sustainable planet by treating nature with dignity and respect and even compassion as a critical part of what it will take to get us to a better place.
And I'm gonna have to say sorry to everyone because I have to go to another webinar about the ocean decay on science, which is extremely important to discussion. But I just wanna also say, you know, I think thanking Ali and Lucy, and as you started also, Sylvia, with the question of, you know, how we question ourselves. I remember always a meeting we were with Sylvia a couple of years ago, and about salmon farming. And so the question was how we improve salmon farming. So, and Sylvia made a first question, you know, like raising her hand and saying, do we need salmon farming to begin with? And I think the questioning ourselves of, because we're trying to fix a broken tool here, you know? And no matter what you do, it is a broken tool. The way that we've been using the resources, if you want to call it, the way that we've been using life on in the ocean, it is a broken tool. So then, you know, you question, do we really need salmon farming? Do we really need salmon in I don't know, in your sushi, in your plate? Do we really need that? I guess there are some people who need those fish in some specific communities, maybe in Alaska, maybe some other places where their culture is related with them. They at a certain point, they might not gonna have even the chance, because we have been changing the nature of salmon already, genetically and in many other ways. So the question is for us who have the power to actually decide whether we want or not that. It's a valid question and it re-empowers us. It might not gonna fix the problem. It might not gonna fix the work completely. And that's what I always say, elect officials that actually can do good. But yes, we can do good. We can change. I mean, marketing has been made for us to buy things. And those buying things have been driving the destruction of complete ecosystems. So we can do the reverse too. Yes, we can take that decision in our hands. We also can do more than that for sure. So I want to thank you, Ali and Lucy, and sorry for leaving before. I will be more than glad to take any questions maybe through my Instagram or Twitter or my email too. I will be happy, but thank you so much for this discussion.
Thanks, Max. I think it's a good opportunity. There's a few good questions popping up, and this is a beautiful discussion that can just go deeper and deeper. But there's a couple here that I think we should address. Like, there's a chap, Kiddist, in Ethiopia, we don't have oceans, but most of our waters in the south contain edible fishes, and the people there highly depend on eating fish. How can we educate and shift the mentality of the people whose lives depend on the fishing industry in third world countries like Ethiopia?
Sylvia, or did you want to go?
Don't eat fish.
I can chip in on that. I mean, Ethiopia is an interesting, it's starting to be quite a developed East African nation. And I just don't know enough information to be able to give good advice on that. But I do think that as a general rule, we find that the more developed nations tend to be having the bigger impact on the oceans with the largest killing machines, the largest floating slaughterhouses out there. And, I think if anyone's in a position where they don't need to eat marine life or any wildlife for that matter, then it might be a good idea to shift towards plant-based food options. But I'm going to leave it there because I don't know enough about the
Ethiopia. Well, as we showed in the film with Liberia, the best thing that we can do when we do have the choice for those communities who do rely on fish is to leave it off our plates as much as possible.
And last point on this, I promise, is I find it really interesting that we're having to always preface talking about shifting towards plant-based food systems and not killing wildlife with the caveat of people who rely on them, okay, fine. When we don't have this conversation when it comes to, elephant poaching or the poaching of tigers, because we accept that that's just taken for granted. So I just want to put it out there that even in these conversations, it's coming through with this sort of speciesism when it comes to talking about fish as a resource, as opposed to elephants and rhinos and tigers.
Same with plastic. When people say just reduce your plastic, eliminate your plastic, of course, we're not talking about doctors who need plastic syringes to save lives. We're not talking about people, when they need to get bottled water to them or else they're going to die. Obviously, these people are not part of it. So yeah, I just wanted to add to that.
I'm not sure if we answered the question, but we'll leave it there.
No, but you raise a good point. And there's many people on this call that are, they want to move along the needle of change. They do want to make moves. Another great question that came in here from Inez is, what are the alternative livelihoods that can in the short term ensure communities will not be harmed? So there are those balances. Sylvia, you're with the Hope Spots, you're helping a lot of island communities around the world elevate where they're going. Some of the suggestions there that people can be aware of.
The largest impact right now is the industrial fishing that is new. I mean, relatively new in my lifetime. We began scaling up the large scale extraction, even of whales in the 20th century, where whales were taken as technology made it easier to travel over long distances and process whales at sea. We came very close to eliminating some of the great whales because we got so good at killing them and marketing them. The same is true with now other wild animals in the sea. When people don't think of tuna as being a wild animal, they think of tuna as just being a fish. I don't know how you can have that mindset. But of course, all ocean life occurs there naturally. They're wild animals. And by just saying that we should eliminate industrial fishing from the high seas in a stroke would, or taking away the subsidies that makes it profitable to extract on a scale that is beyond what the ocean can continue to produce. Those two things would at once, something that we can do on our watch right now, and they are under consideration. Protect the high seas from industrial fishing. Just leave it as the cornerstone of our life support system, the place that is so important for generating oxygen, capturing carbon, maintaining the integrity of the planet as our home. And that and meanwhile, looking at coastal areas and getting serious about large-scale protection, at least 30%, where you leave the wild animals intact. And seriously, protecting coral reefs means protecting the whole reef system, not harming the coral, but you don't take the parrotfish either. You don't take the surgeonfish, you don't take the grouper. You leave those as vital areas that can serve to restore depleted areas around them. So what can you do about livelihoods? Well, we know that if you do have protected areas, there will be more fish in adjacent areas, but you've got to get serious. You can't just move protection around from this place to that, have closed times for a short period of time to allow a 30-year-old fish to recover. Come on, close it one season and open up the next. No, I mean, these are gimmicks, if you will. But to get serious about having major areas that you leave alone and look for alternative ways to make a living, livelihoods. There's one thing about taking wildlife as a source of sustenance. And at least at this point in time, there are people, whether it's on the land in a forest, who still take wildlife, bushmeat, as a source of sustenance. And we condone, if this is what you have to eat, then we'll try to accommodate that within the big picture. And the same with coastal communities, island countries. But once you start using wildlife as money, whether it's rhinoceros horn, pangolin scales, elephant ivory, walrus ivory, whatever it is, then you get into this dilemma. You're not eating the animals, you're using the animals as money. It's wildlife trade. And it's a different story. And throughout all of history, going back 10,000 years, yes, people have always consumed animals one way or the other, but the major part of the diet of humans throughout history, and even now, even those who consider themselves carnivores, large portion of calories actually and sustenance. I mean, the real nutrition largely comes from plants. And I'm not making this up. Ollie and Lucy aren't making this up. We aren't, just saying gotta eat plants. There's a whole movement around the world saying if we're going to feed 8 billion people, we've got to shift our habits that have largely come about in the 20th century, that every meal to have some form of meat as a primary source of what you consume, it just isn't going to work for 8 billion people. It's just a fact. And whether it's for your personal health or the health of the planet, it just, we're looking at calories. If we focus more on plants as a primary source of calories, which they already are, and the primary source of nutrients, which they already are, the things that occur in plants that don't occur in any form of animal, what food, if you will, animals as food. We have to think differently if we are going to accommodate healthy people on a planet that stays a certain size. The planet doesn't grow, our numbers are growing. And livelihoods to accommodate all those people as well as a source of sustenance. We just have to be creative. Okay, let me get back to the point about what do you do about fishermen? I think it's almost insulting to say to fishermen that they can only do one thing. We all have the capacity to be creative, and we have to think in terms of here is my world, and I have the capacity to live within my means, whatever that world is. And whether it's on a small scale in a village or a big scale, looking at how are all of us going to live within our means, we have to look at the reality of what we've got. Right now, we have a greatly depleted planet. And I can't really tell fishermen in a village somewhere what you can actually do, but I do believe that we can be sympathetic and be empathetic and to do whatever we can from outside to help create alternative means for transition time. We can't continue to take wildlife on the scale that we currently are and have a planet that continues to work in our favor. That's pretty clear. And whether it's out in the high seas, in the coastal zones, or even looking at what are the limits within your village, can you take and still have fish to take? Everyone can see what happens when you take too much. And everyone can see the benefits of having areas that you protect so that you can have regenerative sources. We have knowledge that didn't exist 100 years ago or even 50 years ago. Being able to transfer that insight to people around the world, whether it's in cities or in the villages that are closer to the sources, natural sources of what they consume. I think we have the ability to make that transition, but on a big scale that will help the small scale fishers, gotta stop this industrial extraction that is taking away the potential for the small scale fishermen to actually survive.
I think that's a beautiful near wrap to our fabulous Zoom this evening. Ali and Lucy, any closing thoughts to build on Dr. Earle's points that you'd like to end on?
No, I think just that it's been a real pleasure as always being on here. And I don't think we should ever underestimate the creative abilities that people have to adapt and grow. And we've done that with adapting to the diminishment, but I think we should now start adapting before it gets to that point. And whether that be shifting to the cultivation of kelp farms and those kind of marine plants, marine plant algae, those kinds of things that fishermen have been transitioning to, that's great. But no, it's been a real pleasure. I don't know if you've got anything else.
Oh yeah, just thank you so much for having us on. A real pleasure as always, Dr. Sylvia Earle. And just to add that everyone, it's going to be a team effort, I think, to really turn things around for the ocean. And we need change at all levels, individual, organizational, companies, at the government. We need change on all levels. And I think
on that note, we, if there's anyone that hasn't already signed our petition to protect 30% of our seas by the year 2030 from industrial fishing, change.org/Seaspiracy. It's nearly 700,000, almost 700,000 signatures. So maybe some people in the audience can help help us get there. We'll be delivering these to world leaders at the G7 summit next month. Joe Biden will be there, Boris Johnson will be there, and we'll be creating, well, we've got some big plans. We're going to keep it secret, but they're going to hear us and it's going to be huge. So let's get it going as a minimum goal. And maybe by 2050, we'll do 50% of our oceans.
Excellent, excellent. Ali, Lucy, thank you so much for sharing your great work and inspiring us. If people are listening and they're not disrupting the conversation out there, then we're not doing anything for good. So now is our chance. We have a limited clock. Dr. Earle, thank you so much again for your incredible deep and beauty of intelligence and thoughts and endless curiosity we should all be following to ensure that this planet does take the test of time forwards. So thank you all for joining us. From all of us at Mission Blue, at the different groups over at Disrupt Studios and at the Elevation Barn, we thank you for joining us this evening and supporting this incredible effort to help sustain our oceans. Have a beautiful evening and a good day.
Thank you very much. See you later.
Bye.